Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship this morning at First English Lutheran Church in Wisconsin Rapids, Wisconsin. It's good to see all of you here, especially all the visitors. There's a whole bunch of you. So welcome to worship. We pray that your time here will be filled with God's presence and joy and a sense of belonging as children of God together. And welcome to those of you who are our online community. I have a few names here today: Jenny, Dorothy, Mary Jo, Ellen, Marge, Karen, Chuck, and Carol. And we know there's more of you, and we're glad you're with us too. We are especially thankful for the flowers this morning from Anne Hanschke in honor of Ronnie's birthday and Sari's homecoming day. And we see that the family is here together, so we're glad you're here. And congratulations on those important days in your lives. Now, as we are approaching fall, this is the busiest time in the church year for those of us who spend our days, and sometimes it feels like our nights, here in the fall. And so there's a few more announcements that I would just like to share with you. Next Sunday is God's Work, Our Hands. We still have places for you to sign up where you can share your hands and your feet to help fellow members and our community. Please take a look at the bulletin board. And when you sign up for wherever you're going to work, sign up for the luncheon too, so we know how many people to prepare for. It's such a good week. We'll be having worship at 8 o'clock. We'll be done by 8:30 or so, and then we will go out to our work sites. So it's always just a full and fun day together, and we come back and eat lunch together at noon. Also, Bible studies and book studies will be starting after that on the 15th. So you'll be getting more information this week and probably a brochure next week, but would just like to say there's a six-week study starting right after worship on the book of Colossians. Lou Berg will be teaching that. And then there will be a time at 8:30 in the morning before church starts, a time for something called Lectio Divina, which is an ancient way of studying scripture where you read the scripture and you listen and you say what comes to your mind. And it's not like you have to come and know a whole bunch of stuff. You learn to listen to what God is saying to you as an individual and also as a group. And Ann Kroll will be leading that before worship, and will be done by 9:15, so you can come in and find your favorite place to sit. And then there will also be a 6 o'clock book study called Living a Life of Doing Enough and Being Enough. In other words, the topic is, how do we know we're enough? You know, we struggle with that. So that's a 6 o'clock Zoom for those of you who have to get to work by 8, but you'll have a time to be able to spend time with other Christians, and we'll talk more about the day that will be later. Rally Day on September 15th, it's all outlined in your bulletin. Sunday school sign-up is going on. Please do that. We still need some volunteers to help out. Okay, that's it. At least for now. Please stand as we prepare our hearts for worship. Almighty God, we praise the majesty of your name in all the earth. Thank you that you so joyously welcome us into your presence today. Thank you that we can gather as brothers and sisters in Christ to worship you and focus on you for this next hour. We pray, as always, that you will open our eyes and our hearts and our ears and our minds, so we are receptive to what you have to say to us. In Jesus' name, amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Joined to Christ, joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are clothed with God's mercy and forgiveness. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your Spirit moved over the waters, and by your word you created the world, calling forth life in which you took delight. We praise you for the gift of water that sustains life, and above all, we praise you for the gift of new life in Jesus Christ. Shower us with your Spirit and renew our lives with your forgiveness, grace, and love. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord in the unity of the Holy Spirit now and forever. Amen. Please remain standing as we sing together our gathering hymn, Praise Ye the Lord. Job. That was fun. Once we figure out where all those words go. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
If you're able, please stay standing for the Kyrie and Canticle of Praise.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O God, our strength, without you we are weak and wayward creatures. Protect us from all dangers that attack us from the outside, and cleanse us from all evil that arises from within ourselves, that we may be preserved through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
The first reading today is from Deuteronomy chapter 4, beginning with verse 1. The Israelites believed the law was a divine gift that provided guidelines for living out the covenant. Moses commands the people to obey the law and to neither add to nor subtract from it. The Israelites are also to teach the law to their children and their children's children. So now, Israel, give heed to the statutes and ordinances that I am teaching you to observe, so that you may live to enter and occupy the land that the Lord, the God of your ancestors, is giving you. You must neither add anything to what I command you, nor take away anything from it, but keep the commandments of the Lord your God with which I am charging you. You must observe them diligently, for this will show your wisdom and discernment to the peoples who, when they hear all these statutes, will say, "Surely this great nation is a wise and discerning people." For what other great nation has a God so near to it as the Lord our God is whenever we call to him? And what other nation has statutes and ordinances as just as this entire law that I am setting before you today? Take care and watch yourselves closely, so as neither to forget the things that your eyes have seen, nor to let them slip from your mind all the days of your life. Make them known to your children and your children's children. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks
be to God. Second reading is from James chapter 1, starting with verse 17. The letter of James was intended to provide first century Christians with instructions in godly behavior. Here, Christians are encouraged to listen carefully and to act on what they hear, especially by caring for those least able to care for themselves. Every generous act of giving with every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. In fulfillment of his own purpose, he gave us birth by the word of truth, so that we would become a kind of first fruits of his creatures. You must understand this, my beloved. Let everyone be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger, for your anger does not produce God's righteousness. Therefore, rid yourself of all sordidness and rank growth of wickedness, and welcome with meekness the implanted word that has the power to save your souls. But be doers of the word, and not merely hearers who deceive themselves. For if any are hearers of the word and not doers, they are like those who look at themselves in a mirror. For they look at themselves and on going away immediately forget what they were like. But those who look into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and persevere, being not hearers who forget, but doers who act, they will be blessed in their doing. If any think they are religious and do not bridle their tongues, but deceive their hearts, their religion is worthless. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this, to care for orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself unstained by the world. Word of God, word of life.
Come on up for the children's sermon, kids. Over here. Come on up here. Have a seat. Any more? I saw more. It's okay. Ah, how are you? School coming. Are you glad or sad? Glad. Could go either way, depending on how you feel in the morning, right? How about you, Livy? Yeah, it's about time. You get to that point. Do you remember when you first learned what was right and what was wrong? No? No. I wonder how you knew that. Did anybody teach it to you? Or did you just, 2 days old, you already knew what was right and wrong? Wow, I didn't get one of those kids. I think the reason we know what's right and wrong is because we have people who help us learn, right? Your parents, your grandparents, your teachers at school. And little by little, we absorb that and learn that. Now, I'm just going to tell a little story on myself. I don't think you have heard it yet. Maybe kids from farther back have heard it. But when I was about six, I'd say, I didn't know what a lie was. And so I started telling them. You know, my mom would say, did you do that? I'd say, no, the little kids did it. You know, my younger brother and sister. And then my mom would call me in the house and say, Cheryl, they aren't home. Who do you, you must have done it. And I go, okay, busted. And then I'd get punished for it. And then I did it again for something else. And my mom said, that's wrong. You don't tell things that aren't true. And so then I started learning about what was true. And then she would show me the Bible verses that said not to say things that are not true about other people. And then I did it again. And I was in first grade, and I stole the chalk from my teacher because I really liked colored chalk, and I hid it because now I knew I was doing something wrong. And my mom found it. Where did this chalk come from? I don't know. My teacher gave it to me, Cheryl. And guess what I had to do then? I had to take the chalk with my mom back to school and apologize to my teacher and ask her to forgive me. Do you think I learned what was right and wrong? That was the home run. Yeah, that time I really learned what was wrong. And you know what my teacher said to me? She said, I forgive you. You get to start over. Isn't that cool when you get a do-over? Today we're going to be talking about getting a do-over. All of us do things that are wrong, think things that are wrong, say things we shouldn't. And God is always willing to forgive us and give us a do-over where we get to start fresh and clean. You think that's a good thing? That's a really good thing. Otherwise, we'd be stuck in all of our lies and our mean words. But God gives us do-overs, and so do people around us. How do you think it feels when you get a do-over? What do you think, Nora? We're getting the thumbs today. Two thumbs up when you get a do-over, right? Do you think you feel free? We have a bunch of deer in our backyard this year, and we have some fawns. And one of them is so happy to be a fawn. I don't know if it got a do-over. But it ran from our yard into the woods back around 4 times in a row just because it was so happy. That's what it feels like to get a do-over. Let's thank Jesus for do-overs. Lord Jesus, thank you for forgiving us. Thank you for the people who teach us what's right and wrong. Thank you for the joy of being forgiven. We pray in your name. Amen. Now, if you want, you can run around the church 4 times before you sit down. Just kidding. Please stand for the hallelujah. Thank you. The Holy Gospel according to Mark, the 7th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Now, when the Pharisees and some of the scribes who had come from Jerusalem gathered around Jesus, they noticed that some of his disciples were eating with defiled hands, that is, without washing them. For the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they thoroughly wash their hands, thus observing the tradition of the elders. And they do not eat anything from the market unless they wash it. And there are also many other traditions that they observe, the washing of cups, pots, and bronze kettles. So the Pharisees and the scribes asked him, "Why do your disciples not live according to the tradition of the elders, but eat with defiled hands?" He said to them, "Isaiah prophesied rightly about you hypocrites, as it is written, 'This people honors me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching human precepts as doctrines.' You abandon the commandment of God and hold to human tradition." Then he called the crowd again and said to them, "Listen to me, all of you, and understand. There is nothing outside a person that by going in can defile, but the things that come out are what defile. For it is from within, from the human heart, that evil intentions come: fornication, theft, murder, adultery, avarice, wickedness, deceit, licentiousness, envy, slander, pride, folly. All these evil things come from within, and they defile a person." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. You might want to take your bulletin home and look up some of those words. Check out the thesaurus on your computer. I was completely confident I'd get an A when I handed in my first paper in my college literature class. After all, I was a 50-year-old freshman who'd been writing for about 43 years. I knew my paper would come back with glowing comments. So I blinked hard when I saw a huge X drawn through the first page and comments on it like, "This is not a critical essay. You have missed the purpose of the assignment. Do over." Yeah. "And then make an appointment with me so we can discuss." Oh, I was so mad. I cooled down after a couple days and made the appointment. I was sitting on the floor outside her office when she opened the door. I pulled the paper out, looked her in the eye, and said, "I've never written a critical essay before, and I don't know how to do it." She grinned at me, and we set to work. When we'd finished, she said, "I hope you understand why I did what I did. You're a Christian, and you understand baptism, right?" "Well, what I did was sort of like a baptism. I dunked you under and brought you back up to new life so you would learn to write better and differently." She didn't say your pride needed a hit, and for that I was grateful. What felt like a punishment was clearly a gift. A do-over is a gift of grace. It's a second chance, and you get to try to get it right this time. Well, that's exactly what's happening in Deuteronomy today. The Israelites are standing on the threshold of a do-over, according to biblical scholar Dr. Walter Brueggemann. The Israelites as a nation are getting a second chance to choose faith instead of fear. 40 years earlier, just 11 months into their wilderness journey, God had led them right to the edge of Canaan, to a land flowing with milk and honey and good food and security. God had promised them this land and would make it possible for them to possess this land and live there safely. No longer nomads, they'd get to build homes and plant crops and raise their families, and there would be peace. But the people said no and chose fear. They saw only the negative, why it wouldn't work, why they couldn't do it. Even though God had delivered them from slavery in Egypt and opened the Red Sea for them to walk through and guided them every day by Moses and had given them a righteous law that would ensure their safety and stability as a community, even though God had been that faithful, they still chose fear instead of trusting God. Well, they couldn't go into the promised land if they wouldn't trust God. So they spent the next 39 years, essentially, being fearful. And that whole first generation out of Egypt ended up dying in the wilderness. However, the next generation is still alive. And they're standing on the threshold of a do-over. They're standing there ready to trust God together. They're on the boundary between the old and the new, between fear and faith. And Moses speaks to them throughout the entire book of Deuteronomy. This is a sermon. Aren't you thankful that you did not have to stand through that whole thing, because it's many, many, many chapters long. He speaks through the entire book of Deuteronomy about this do-over and about what will happen next. He knows he's going to die soon, so every word matters. Hey, Israel, this has to happen. Take the statutes and the ordinances of the Lord seriously. They are gifts for you, straight from God's heart of love. God knows you. God knows what's necessary for you to thrive. And if you observe God's commands with willing hearts, you will live fruitful and good lives. God's commandments never make our lives miserable. God gives them so that we might live, so that we'll flourish, so that we'll be free to live with joy and trust, so that we won't hurt each other and destroy the community God has given us. Moses emphasizes the integrity and the righteousness of the commandments. They are just what God intends for his beloved people. So don't add anything to them to make them more pleasing to you. And don't leave out the stuff you don't like. Obey them as they are, because these are from the Lord for you, so that your lives will be abundantly good. He continues, "Now, folks, if you follow them diligently, not just when life is falling apart because you didn't follow them, but if you follow them diligently, all the nations around you will see that you are a wise and discerning people, and that you have a God who is near to you and loves you so much that he has given you a written law to guide you. Except for Hammurabi's code of law in Babylon, no nations had written laws at this time. And yet the God of Israel loved God's people enough to give them a written law, to care about their behavior and their relationships with others. Moses knew that this people he'd been with for 40 years, this nation would fall apart if they forgot God's commandments. Remember, people, how God has provided for you. Choose faith over fear every time. Follow the Lord God Almighty. Furthermore, teach the faith to your children and your grandchildren so that they too will be alert for God and understand God's love and God's promises, so that they too will be able to name their own experiences with God and trust in God and pass on their understanding and discernment to the next generation and the next. If the faith is passed on, the nation will flourish." Joshua was the leader who followed Moses. He led the people into the promised land. We read in Joshua 24:31, Israel served the Lord throughout the lifetime of Joshua and of the elders who outlived him and who had experienced everything the Lord had done for Israel. Now, we spent July this summer studying Gideon, and we know that the people of Israel would go through a cycle where as long as someone was living who knew what God was, who God was and what they had experienced, the people would serve God. And when those people died, the people would turn away from God and serve idols, and the evil would flourish in the land, and God's faithfulness, those stories weren't shared anymore. And the people depended on themselves, and God's goodness ceased to flourish, and evil would take over. And then when it would become unbearable, they'd cry out to God again, and God would raise up a prophet, and the nation would be given another do-over. They'd follow the Lord once more until they didn't. When we arrive today in the New Testament, especially our gospel, we see that the religious leaders have maintained the appearance of following God. They are obedient not only to every bit of God's law, but also to every bit of human law that's been drummed up over the years. 613 laws. Mark wrote, I'm sure you caught it, for the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they thoroughly wash their hands, thus observing the tradition of the elders. They do not eat anything from the market unless they wash it, and there are also many other traditions they observe, like the washing of cups, pots, and bronze kettles. Well, with all this great obedience on their side, they look at Jesus' disciples who are eating food without washing their hands first, and they say, why are they eating with defiled hands? I always try to imagine Jesus' tone of voice when he replies to criticisms from the Pharisees or other people. Was he really angry? Was his face angry? Was he yelling? We don't know. But we do know that the truth he speaks, the truth makes them angry. The truth makes them angry. He says, you know, Isaiah prophesied rightly about you hypocrites. That probably makes them angry. This people honors me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching human precepts as doctrines or as the truth of God. Obviously, there's a do-over needed here. The people who are counting on their own rule-keeping, all their little tiny infinitesimal obediences, they need to believe that loving God above all and loving other humans is God's greatest commandment. It's not about their performance. It's not about trying to clean up by washing their hands at certain times or cleansing their pots and pans or using certain pots and pans. It's about having their inner beings, and we are included, our inner beings, cleansed and transformed by God's forgiveness of their sins and our sins. Because our inner beings are where evil intentions come from. And that's where God wants to start with us, making us new from the inside out, not just pasting on good behavior. Whenever we admit our sin and our need for forgiveness, we get a do-over, a fresh start, another chance. Have you ever struggled, and I first of all will admit I have you ever struggled with what you might have called your character flaw? Uncontrolled temper, judgmentalism of others, arrogance, incorrect use of sexuality, misuse of God's name and inappropriate language, lying, gossip, nursing grudges, and having an unforgiving spirit, impatience, pride, greed, there's such a list. Putting convenience or materialism ahead of the Lord. The list just goes on. We've been there. We've done that. There's nobody in this room who hasn't sinned. Have you ever found yourself defending it or attempting to cover it up in public, trying to appear holier than you know you are? Well, the religious folk in Jesus' day were like that. And even so, Jesus was there with them. And he was offering them his forgiveness and healing. And even so, they couldn't hear it. And they chose to cling to their own version of righteousness, which depended on their own efforts. And they could not hear the truth. They could not and would not receive Jesus. However, for those who could no longer cover up their sins, the tax collectors, the prostitutes, the people who were public sinners, whatever that means, the people who didn't appear holy in any way, Jesus was right there with them too, healing them, loving them, forgiving their sins, and giving them do-overs and fresh starts and a chance to live with purpose and joy. And they eagerly received him. And so here we are. And here Jesus is. He is here with us today through the Holy Spirit. And that is good news for all of us. We can give up our pretension and we can receive Jesus just as we are, knowing that we may be weak, but he is strong. We may have sinned, but he is forgiveness. We may have despaired of changing ourselves, but Jesus is our do-over. A do-over is a gift of grace. Maybe it's a professor dunking you in your own pride to teach you a new way. But even better, it's Jesus Christ surrounding you with his righteousness and giving you the courage and the faith to live this life with him, with his almighty strength and joy. Thanks be to God. Amen. Shall we sing? That's worth singing about. Why don't you stand up and let's sing here on Jesus Christ, I Will Stand. We've done this a couple weeks, and I think you're getting the hang of it. Let's just sing it out.
Thank you.
Together with the church all over the world, let us confess our Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Together in the power of the Holy Spirit, we pray with confidence for the world, the church, God's good creation, and all who are in need. God of every generation, give the church a sense of purpose to reach those who have not heard of you. Sustain and build up leaders and lay people as we accompany one another in our life with Christ. Merciful God,
receive our prayer. God of creation, you named humans as partners with you to bring your kingdom to earth as it is in heaven. Where war and disaster exist, bring peace and successful relief efforts from the world community. Guide governments of all nations to care about the people in their care. Bring justice to those who have no homes, nowhere to flee, and little hope for survival. We remember especially those in the Mideast, Sudan and Ukraine. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Sovereign God, we pray for us American citizens as we experience another election cycle. Help us to seek your wisdom. Teach us to discern your truth. Keep us faithful to the commandments you have given us. Give us peace in our hearts and peace with those who do not agree with us. Keep us from arrogance and deceit. Merciful God,
receive our prayer. Healing God, you draw near to all who are hurting. Be with all who desire relief from chronic and acute illness, cancer and PTSD. Strengthen healthcare workers, therapists, and caregivers. Tend to those who are close to our hearts, Joanne and Bob Otava, Mary and John Engeling, Steve Humphrey, Lucy, Ryan Ehlig, Walt and Wanda Wright, the Williams family, Richard Brunner, those who have recently received dementia diagnoses, and those who live with it every day. Merciful God,
receive our prayer. On this Labor Day weekend, we remember and give thanks for all who have fought for workers' rights around the world. continue to improve working conditions and establish fair wages so that all people may thrive. Merciful God,
receive our prayer. Comforting God, console us as we mourn our departed. We pray especially for Lori and her family as they grieve the loss of Lori's father last night, Carl. We pray that you will give them comfort and peace. We think too of those who are enduring their first year or two of loss. We know how much life changes and how difficult it is. We pray that you will enable them to receive your presence and comfort. Help them to hold fast to the promise that death has been defeated by our Savior, Jesus Christ. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We entrust these and all our prayers to you, Holy God, knowing you have already heard us and are already answering, in the name of your beloved child, Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
Peace of our risen Lord Jesus Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share the Lord's love and peace with one another. Please stand. Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, source of every gift of your creation. By these gifts and with our lives, help us to serve one another and all in need through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Give you thanks, Father, through Jesus Christ, your beloved Son, whom you sent in this end of the ages to save and redeem us and to proclaim to us your will. He is your Word, inseparable from you, through whom you created all things and in whom you take delight. He is your Word, sent from heaven to a virgin's womb. He then took on our nature and our lot, and was shown forth as your Son, born of the Holy Spirit and of the Virgin Mary. He, our Lord Jesus, fulfilled all your will and won for you a holy people. He stretched out his hands in suffering in order to free from suffering those who trust you. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took the bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering then his death and resurrection, we take this bread and this cup, giving you thanks that you have made us worthy to stand before you and to serve you as your priestly people. Send your Spirit upon these gifts of your church. Gather into one all who share this bread and wine. Fill us with your Holy Spirit to establish our faith in truth, that we may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ, through whom all glory and honor are yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, both now and forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let's pray in the words Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. You are welcome to share in the bread and wine the body and blood of Christ, if you believe Jesus is the Son of God, that he has died to forgive you your sins and risen again to give you eternal life. We don't restrict communion here by denomination. This is the Lord's table, and you are welcome here. If you're new with us, we'll be coming around the communion rail today to receive communion, and the elements will be brought to you. One thing I would like to mention is if you prefer grape juice instead of wine, the grape juice you'll see is right in the middle of the tray. It's a little bit lighter purple, and if you aren't sure which it is, just ask your server, and she'll help you out with that. The feast is ready. Come, taste and see. The Lord is so good.
Thank you.
Please stand. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and preserve you in his grace. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. O God, our life, our strength, our food, we give you thanks for sustaining us with the body and blood of your Son. By your Holy Spirit, enliven us to be his body in the world, that more and more we will give you praise and serve your earth and its many peoples. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Receive the blessing. God Almighty, I can't see it anymore. Okay, God Almighty, God most merciful, bless you, keep you, and give you peace. Amen. Amen. The Lord now sends us forth. Here we go. Have a good week, everyone. Follow Jesus.